El Zorro Plateador proudly presents The Anatomy of Female Power, a Masculinist Dissection of Matriarchy by Chinweizu, narrated in the winter of 2020. Foreword by El Zorro Plateador. The reason high school biology students dissect frogs is to learn. The purpose of any dissection is to study and comprehend. When you see the inside of a creature, you understand it in a new way. You see its function and purpose, and you gain some appreciation for its clever organization. This is why the scientist opens up and inspects the animal he wishes to know. Only after he gains understanding can he take any useful action. However, the creature we must dissect today is no 6-inch amphibian, no cold frog pulled lifeless from a jar of pungent formaldehyde, posing no threat to the high school student grimacing as he inspects it. What we dissect today is very much a live animal, a dangerous predator, known for annihilating its prey, an elusive creature admired for its clever camouflage. A cunning hunter respected for its wily stalking techniques. And the object of our study today is indeed a colossus. I would liken this beast, perhaps, to the size of an underground aquifer, something that spans the horizon and so feeds and fuels the plants living above. This beast is female power, and if we are to dissect it, as does the high school biology student, first, let us admit that it's something we need to understand, and that this understanding will provide some clarity and some leverage. Our first student was born in 1943 in Africa, in a region of eastern Nigeria called Itsukuato. There, in a flat, forested, and rural landscape, a boy named Chinweizu Ibekwe began to observe carefully what was going on around him. There, among the villages and shops, he began to notice patterns of how power organized. In the 1960s, this bright young student showed verbal prowess and a knack for academics, and so was sent to the United States to study in Boston at MIT and then later at SUNY Buffalo. There, he grew into a talented poet, writer, and would go on to challenge the thinking of his peers about African culture and trends affecting Africans. The young man became a prolific author. At these universities, known simply as Chinweizu, he began to delve into the philosophical, artistic, and cultural issues of the Black Power movement. His books, essays, and newspaper articles have since been published in Africa, Europe, and North America. Examples of his most popular and controversial works are 1975's The West and the Rest of Us, White Predators, Black Slavers, and the African Elite, and 1983's Toward the Decolonization of African Literature. But what interests us today is the book he wrote in 1990 at age 47 called The Anatomy of Female Power, A Masculinist Dissection of Matriarchy. Though he is still alive in 2020 as of this writing, 30 years later, this remains his final book. Note how this penetrating thinker and prolific writer stopped publishing right after this. I wonder what happened. Make no mistake, it is probably no coincidence. And as you listen, you may realize why. This book begins immediately with its challenge displayed right on the cover, in a statement that makes clear the book's intended audience. Quote, "For all men who have been confused, misused, and abused by women, particularly since the coming of feminism, and definitely not for women." Unquote. He poses the book as a challenge to feminism, announcing not only that women rule over men, but that they have always done so. "Now is the moment," he says, "to give men the tools to subvert this power structure." This book is an elegant, entertaining, and intellectual look at the animal of dissection, at female power, at its mysterious construction, at its paradoxical implementation, and to men, its formidable might. The organization of this book is graceful and streamlined. To achieve his goal of equipping men with conceptual tools for such a dissection, Chinweizu begins with the question, who rules who, man or woman? Then he states that the concept of the patriarchy, the theory of male empowerment across society and the subjugation of women under them, is nothing but a campaign of propaganda built by feminists and accepted foolishly by men and women alike. However, Chinweizu observes that it is women who dominate men and that it is necessary to examine their feminine powers and the way their influence operates socially. He then structures his thoughts into five parts, starting in part one by introducing the attributes of woman's influence, what he calls the five pillars of female power. In the subsequent sections, he expands these concepts into what he calls mother power in part two, bride power in part three, and wife power in part four. And he concludes in part five with a section devoted to matriarchy and its discontents, in which he unravels the reasons why the different factions within the matriarchy attack itself. He winds down with a fascinating treatise on what he calls the Masculinist, a man free from female power, a man wily in the ways of feminine guile, who is master of himself, his sexuality, and who walks unencumbered by female power. Let us now speak for a moment about power itself. Chinweizu's definition of power is something the biology student must understand from the outset. The underlying themes of this book regarding power are bold and shine like beacons across each chapter. Looking at the structure of the book and the goals that motivate the author, it is possible to identify within the conceptual framework of intergender dynamics and red pill theory an array of commingling and mighty topics, namely the gender war, a gigantic hidden battle over sex, power, and an array of politicized laws hostile to men. In fact, Chinweizu's overall mission is to introduce his ideas on power and to display how this power is organized among the two genders. For Chinweizu, power is simply ability. It is being able to get what one wants, and he adds, quote, "If this is the essence of power, then women are far from powerless," unquote. This definition of power is simple but sufficient for what we need today. It is the ability to get what one wants. It is agency, will, ability, strength, as these are required to get what one wants. We then must ponder how female power is created, and once generated, how this power transmits across individuals, how women exert this power over men. I define power not as the ability to get what one wants, but as the ability to do difficult things. With my definition, let's ask, what difficult things does female power actually do? Ah, this. The achievement of the matriarchal society is that of a life of luxury, a life within a paradise of affluence, a life within a society built by men to serve women. Although Chinweizu acknowledges how women are not well represented in public and institutional structures, he observes how there are many other sources of power, such as in education, propaganda, punishment, recognition, etc., that they do possess. This means that in society there is room for both genders, and that despite our society appearing overtly patriarchal, there lies behind the scenes a robust, powerful and muscular engine of female power, a hidden matriarchy. This matriarchy is the clandestine structure of power of women over men. Chinweizu writes, quote, "Because every man has as boss his wife, or his mother, or some other woman in his life, men may rule the world, but women rule the men who rule the world," unquote. Chinweizu therefore assures that female power over males exists and manifests itself across five main pillars of female power. 1. Her control of her womb. 2. Her control over the kitchen. 3. Her control of her child's cradle. 4. The psychological immaturity of men compared to women. And 5. Man's tendency to be deranged by his own excited penis. Chinweizu also condenses these five pillars into three phases of the man, woman, and family script: mother power, bride power, and wife power. He still finds room to describe the character of both genders, attributing to men the macho qualities of strength, confrontation, aggression, and control, and to women the dainty qualities of calm, passivity, emotionality, and the ability to manipulate, making visible masculine power while hiding feminine power. Chinweizu identifies how these female characteristics are purposefully used to deceive men so as to govern them in a covert and troubling way. Like all great thinkers, Chinweizu built his own custom vocabulary to describe the object of his fascination, the power dynamics across the genders. The three types of female power he identifies are mother power, bride power, and wife power. These words apply to stages in a woman's life, phases in which she can exert her influence to get what she wants. Mother power is the influence a mother has over her son or daughter and how she prepares her son for the future role as husband. Look for a moment at the words wife and husband. The word wife has no etymological roots and is free of any associations aside from an old word referring to female genitalia. It is almost as if the term wife sprang out of nowhere, fully formed. We can see immediately when we look at its etymology, the term husband has an intimate connection to the idea of work. The word husband derives from two roots from Old Norse, hus, meaning house, and bondi, meaning occupier and tiller of the soil. So, the word husband is intertwined with the concept of work and farming, one might even say the life of a slave. And in the culling of animals for meat, we have the term animal husbandry, which is a branch of agriculture concerned with animals raised to be consumed. Animal husbandry includes day-to-day care, selective breeding, and the raising of livestock. It does not take a conceptual leap of great distance to connect the farming of animals to the farming of men. We are being farmed. In Part 5, he refers to men using the term helots, which refers to the social structure of ancient Sparta, whose warmongering culture was divided into three sections: the slaves, the Spartans who owned them, and the helot, who was the peasant class of underlings, lesser citizens, non-voting members of the underclass, the serfs. This is what he calls men in the legal sense. This is how Chinweizu connects being a husband to being a slave, one used and consumed by the slave master the way a farmer consumes an ox. He even calls husbands nest slaves. This makes sense as he comes from his background in African studies and in participating and studying Black Power in the 60s. A common theme running throughout this book is the similarity between being a slave and being a husband. Marriage, he says, is nest slavery. Let's take a moment and put our author, Chinweizu, within recent developments of 2020. In many ways, I feel as if this book was written by an exceedingly intelligent man, but who lived in the dark ages. Had he written this book today, he would have added much more subtlety. In this book, Chinweizu writes essentially about beta men, the wedding as woman's victory parade, and the living nightmare of the beta male's marriage. There is no discussion how men differ among themselves, how there are wild differences among men and their personalities. He makes no accommodation for the high-value man or the phenomenon known as the alpha pass. He makes no discussion of the sexual marketplace. He avoids talk of the pickup artist, the womanizer, the lecherous cad. He makes no mention of game. There was, in 1990, no real internet as we know it, no social media, no Instagram. There was little in the way of white knighting, no damseling, no MGTOW. Things were different then. He writes, quote, "As we have seen from this inquiry, marriage is the central institution of female power, not political parties, parliaments, armies, business enterprises, bureaucracies, etc." Unquote. But we see today the active erosion of the institution of marriage, its hostile laws and divorce mechanisms, and that many women are postponing marriage, delaying it, foregoing, avoiding it, poisoning it. He writes, quote, "As the prime beneficiaries of the system which feminists would dismantle, the quiet army of satisfied matriarchists is the great immovable rock upon which the tidal wave of feminism spends its fury." Unquote. There are gaps in Chinweizu's tool set. Dominant men, although rare, can be found today. So how does this framework of power, of women enjoying covert matriarchal power over men, explain men like President Donald Trump, a relentless and ruthless womanizer? Or to lecherous ones like Bill Clinton? How do we see their wives? How can we view the devious rascality of men like Jeffrey Epstein and the women around them? How does it apply to rapacious athletic superstars like Mike Tyson, Kobe Bryant, or Michael Jordan? These men are all apex alpha males, capable of attracting to themselves women in great numbers. How does this structure of female power apply to them? Chinweizu provides no answer for this. His book aims only at the regular rank-and-file simple man who only wants a family and a woman to love. He is innocent and kind and naive. And it is this naivete that bothers me. Would he have written this book today, I think he would have attacked this foolhardy innocence more directly, because he does so, but only at the very end of this book, where he makes a kind of manifesto for a breed of men he calls the Masculinist. These ideas are quite familiar to us today, particularly within the Red Pill and MGTOW online communities. The Masculinist today has many tools beyond Chinweizu's anatomy of female power, and these tools are controversial. The Masculinist has the skills of the pickup artist. He has what men call game, both in short-term and long-term relationships. He has red pill praxeology to frame human sexual behavior. He understands how today's wildly lopsided family laws favor women and disfavor him. He understands intersexual dynamics and how he must operate within a feminine primary social order. To understand feminism, Chinweizu identifies three distinct attitudes women take toward men, thus forming three basic types of women: the matriarchist, the tomboy, and the termagant. The first, the matriarchist, is a woman who believes that a man's preordained, default, or natural role in life is to serve some matriarch or married mother, and that the best way to get full service out of him is to deceive him into thinking that he is his matriarch's boss. We see this type in traditionally minded wives, the conservative parts of society. This type does not identify herself as a feminist, as she needs men to serve the matriarchy willingly, and so cannot overtly antagonize him or distract him with discussions on gender roles. The second type of woman is the tomboy, who is a woman who would really rather be a man. This type is common among the career-oriented women who compete against men in the workplace and also in lesbian subcultures. The third type of woman is the termagant, a woman, whether tomboy or quasi-matriarchist, who insists on showing her man that she, not he, is boss. She therefore takes sadistic pleasure in harassing and bossing men. The word termagant refers to a harsh-tempered or overbearing woman, a woman of violent and turbulent character. we see termagants in various places where men must serve and interact with women. We see this regularly online on social media. One final note. Chinweizu quotes from various sources throughout the book, and notably from some African people. They are the Igbo, a tribe living in southeast Nigeria, the Bashi, a tribe living in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, formerly known as Zaire, and the Chaga, a tribe from Tanzania. It is helpful to see these quotes within African culture and realize how deep and widespread are matriarchal social structures. It goes back a long, long way into our ancestral and anthropological past. So where do I stand? I see some of the gentler forms of feminism as having a place within society, but its dominance and priority has grown out of control. I do not see all men as rapists, nor do I see all women as gold-digging strumpets. Though I have friends who have been zeroed out and decimated by the divorce machine and family courts. So what did I want from this book? At first, I sought for some way to attack feminism, for a system by which to dismantle it. I wanted a way to see it more clearly than do feminists themselves, to empower myself through this knowledge. The feminine matrix is everywhere, and I wanted not to escape it, no, but move through it and perhaps even use it. Not necessarily to exploit it, but to make things more balanced. Chinweizu does not deliver this. He does not identify a way to destroy feminism. This you won't find. What you will find is a way to handle and coexist with feminism. But I warn you, what he says is painful and disturbing. So let us sit down now in the high school science lab, open the jar, smell the formaldehyde, pull out the frog, and set it on the table. Here we begin our dissection of female power, not to change it, attack it, dismantle it, or destroy it. This we must save for another day, but to study and understand it.